Hello and welcome to UDC Forum. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber, Director for the Humanities at the University of the District of Columbia Community College, and your host. Aviva Kempner Rosenwald is the incredible story of Julius Rosenwald, who never finished high school, but rose to become the President of Sears. Influenced by the writings of the educator Booker T. Washington, this Jewish philanthropist joined forces with African-American communities during the Jim Crow South to build over 5,300 schools during the early part of the 20th century. On this edition of UDC Forum, I will interview Aviva Kempner, the film's director, writer, and producer. She is executive director of the Cecilia Foundation, a nonprofit organization based here in Washington, D.C., that produces documentaries that investigate non-stereotypical images of Jews in history and celebrate the untold stories of Jewish heroes. I'm also proud to note that Aviva Kempner is an alumna of the University of the District of Columbia's David A. Clark School of Law. You will learn more about Aviva Kempner, but first, here's a short preview of Rosenwald.
Julius Rosenwald became partners with Richard Sears in 1895.
Sears was what you could call a swashbuckling salesman. He would sell things he didn't have. He would sell things he didn't even understand. What he enjoyed was the selling. Under Rosenwald's leadership, Sears Roebuck became the largest retailer in the country.
Julius Rosenwald had two personalities. He was a tough businessman. And then, of course, this other side, the civil rights champion, somebody who really saw the disgrace in this country of African Americans being treated so poorly.
Education was seen as a dangerous thing, and white Southerners wanted to keep it out of black people's hands.
Rosenwald was clearly affected by the Jewish belief in tzedakah. Giving charity was justice and righteousness. It was a fundamental commandment.
It's a wonderful story of cooperation between this philanthropist, who did not have to care about black people, but who did, and who expended his considerable wealth in ensuring that they got their fair shake in America. Julius Rosenwald and Booker T. Washington combined with this plan for building black schools, they're engaging in a radical experiment. It's a wonder they were able to achieve it, but achieve it they did. And in the end, 5,000 plus schools are built all over the South.
Aviva, welcome back to UDC and David A. Clark School of Law graduate. Glad to have you back here on campus.
Yes. Actually, it was many years ago, and it was Antioch School of Law then. And I always tease that I have to thank the D.C. bar for flunking me. I did very well in law school, but I do not do well on multiple choice questions. So I took another path, but I'm still very connected to the law school. We're having actually the screening of the film tonight over there, and I've donated artwork, and I just love the kind of work the school does in the spirit of it was when I came here in 73.
Who were some of your heroes?
Well, what was interesting to me in making the film is I learned about Dr. Charles Drew, something we don't ordinarily hear about in school. He was a doctor trained at Howard and had developed the way to keep plasma intact, but also had faced such racism in the field of medicine. And his daughter, Charlene Drew Jarvis, who I had always admired as councilwoman. It was great to get to know her and learn more about her father and realize why he had gotten a grant. And also Charles Hamilton Houston, who was a great civil rights lawyer, the mentor to Thurgood Marshall. He had actually taken footage down in the South to document the case of separate but not equal schools, just like we today take iPhone imagery of police brutality. He was using the camera decades earlier to document his case. So he inspires me both as a lawyer and as a filmmaker. And I'm glad to try to bring him up whenever I talk to say, listen, you know, use your camera as well as your legal briefs to document injustices.
This Rosenwald film has a wide reach. and is very inclusive of other individuals that people may not know about.
Right, both medicine and the law professions, they all were affected and changed by the Rosenwald Grant.
Tell us about your making the film and what drove you.
So it's 14 years ago. I was on Martha's Vineyard vacationing, and there was a talk at the Hebrew Center there called Blacks and Jews, something that is a topic very interesting to myself because I grew up in Detroit. It was a coalition that my father was involved with, I was very involved with, and also here in Washington. So I went because first Rabbi David Saperstein was speaking, but more importantly, Julian Bond, one of my heroes of the Civil Rights Movement. So I'm sitting there thinking I'm going to hear all about, you know, the Civil Rights days. And Julian talks about Julius Rosenwald. And it was like a light bulb went off in my head. And I thought, oh my gosh, this is the next film I have to do. I mean, I just can't believe what kind of, you know, that we don't know about this partnership of 100 years ago. So luckily for me, Julian Bond lived in Washington, not far from me. I got to know he and his wife very well. And he was one of the consultants in the film and is also in the film. And so started my journey. The film was out 2 years ago, went all around the country. And we're very proud because so much of the Cheshire Foundation's imperative is to document lost history. And this is a topic especially important to me because a lot of it is also African-American history combined with Jewish history. And 100 years ago, this great coalition between Julius Rosenwald, who was the philanthropist in Chicago, but also his relationship with Booker T. Washington. He had read Up for Slavery and he thought, oh my gosh, something's wrong, I've got to do something. He had come down to Tuskegee on the request of Booker T. Actually, he had him come to Chicago, which in the hotel that Booker T. appeared at was the first time an African American had been inside as a guest. And at some point, Booker T. said to him, you know what? What we really need, and this is the teens of the last century, is we really need better schools. That the segregation has really affected the quality of the schools. So they built first 5 schools, and then it just morphed to be over more than 5,000. And what was great, it wasn't just Rosenwald building it, it was really in the African American communities doing it, because it was a matching grant premise. He would give a third, Rosenwald, or the Rosenwald Fund. The state had to also kick in, but more importantly, the community did. And we have people like Representative John Lewis who went, the poet Maya Angelou, Eugene Robinson, who is a great Washington Post columnist and MSNBC commentator. And it really made the difference in a lot of these people's lives, especially someone like George Wolfe, who talks so passionately about the director George Wolfe. Now what happened is Rosenwald also got involved in other things. He realized way before the McCarthy Foundation that he should do certain grants with his Rosenwald Fund for young African-American artists and intellectuals. So Jacob Lawrence did his Great Migration series, half of which we're lucky enough to have down at the Phillips Collection. He gave money to Langston Hughes to go around and read his poetry. Baldwin got a Rosenwald. Marian Anderson, who wanted so much to go to Europe and study there and you know, really learn classical opera, went to Europe with a Rosenwald. And that's really where she got discovered and came back here. And it was so so important to her career. One artist, I'm the daughter of an artist, so one artist whose story is really compelling to me is Augusta Savage, who in New York was so much an important part of the Harlem Renaissance, had wanted again to go to Europe to study in Paris, had gotten in to the Fontainebleau program until they realized that she was African American and that would affect the young women she was going with. But luckily there was the Rosenwald Fund who gave her 2 grants and actually a third one. And she really honed on her craft, came back, and when there was the World's Fair in New York in the late 30s, she developed this incredible piece called The Harp, short for it was The Harp, but Lift Up and Sing, based on Weldon Johnson's poem. It turned into a song, and it was like the cause célèbre. That was the piece most favorite at the World's Fair in 39. However, because she did not have the funds to bring the plaster piece back home or to cast it in bronze, it was destroyed. So I've just written an essay in timing with the DVD coming out so that we can hopefully recreate this grand sculpture, the 16-foot sculpture she had done, and maybe put it in the the new African American Museum. So the whole point of what Rosenwald did back then was to support artists and intellectuals, or the schooling of people who the society was not supporting them. And even in Chicago, he built the Museum of Science and Industry and this wonderful housing complex, the Michigan Garden Apartments, where people like Valerie Jarrett's mother lived in, where Jesse Owens lived, where all the intellectuals came. And, Chicago was full of a renaissance quite like the Harlem Renaissance, and people like Gordon Parks came through. He also got a Rosenwald. And what I'm so proud is I learned so much in making the film, but what has happened now around the country is the response has been incredible. And I think another thing, especially after Charlottesville and some of these horrible attacks on campuses, luckily UDC hasn't been affected, but I know even Georgetown and AU has, I've gotten funding to take the film to different campuses. Like today, we're gonna have a screening tonight, so that communities, especially building on Black and Jewish communities, but the whole communities, that we can learn our common history and learn our history. And in the bonus features of the film are many, many stories that didn't even make it to the film. They're 4.5 hours long, and then there's gonna be a free teaching guide with it, so that we can learn our common history. And the reason I spent another 2 years doing that is I had wonderful interns for years, African-American, white, all college students, and not only one person knew who Marian Anderson was. So now we have this bonus feature that was in the film and also longer it was in the film, but not longer in the bonus feature, talking about her story. And, it's interesting, a lot what compels me to do films about unknown Jewish heroes is the fact that I'm a child of a Holocaust survivor, and that I want to do these positive, inspiring stories so we can counter that kind of anti-Semitism and racism and hatred. And when in doing Rosenwald, I thought, well, there's no way World War II was going to be there. All my other films had been part of that. And it turns out in its final years, the Rosenwald Fund loaned the money to build the Tuskegee Airmen Field, and that's how the film ends. So, it's even more modern day. It goes sooner than that. And I think the other thing the film has done besides telling history is hopefully inspiring a lot of people to give philanthropy, to give money, and to do these matching grants, or to do a way of working with communities so the community works with the funder.
I think one of the things that most people don't know when Rosenwald was giving these matching grants was that the communities were actually matching them. There's this misconception that African Americans are not philanthropists and weren't back then. They didn't do anything. Things were given to them. So this film is tearing that apart and peeling that back and exposing the fact, or presenting the fact, that African American communities were very much interested and actively engaged financially as well in many other ways. But that circle
Well, you could argue they were giving double because they were paying state taxes for their education, so, and not getting what they deserved.
Exactly.
So when the state put in, that was from their taxes, and plus they had all these kind of activities raising the money. And what's even better is today a lot of the schools, the National Trust for Historical Preservation, has gotten involved, and a lot of these schools have been restored as community centers, as schools, as museums, so the memory can be kept alive. And I think the nicest thing is seeing that oftentimes it's integrated activities.
And I think that's important to show. You mentioned the fact that only one of the students knew Marian Anderson. That is always frustrating for a historian or for a documentarian to come across. But I think one of the things that we're going to have to do as this film is coming out and showing individuals this history they didn't know, it's going to spark a lot of interest in finding out other history. And if we are not showing students this history, if there's no way to spark their interest, if we're not talking about it, if we don't know it ourselves, then we're going to continue to have groups of students and large numbers of people who don't know these people. So this film is going to function on so many levels. It's going to spark so much. Let me ask you, during that period of time when Rosenwald was doing this, there were other millionaires, there were other philanthropists. Now, was he unique in the matching grants?
He's unique in the matching grants. Now, there was Carnegie and there was Rockefeller.
Right.
Actually, he sort of took away Embry, who ran the Rosenwald Fund, who he had met working with the Rockefeller Foundation. And they also were very generous in giving. But he was more humble than the others. He didn't need to have his name. Mm. I mean, of course, we see the Carnegie Libraries and Rockefeller, etc. For him, it was, there's a principle in Judaism, tikkun olam, that part of the reason he was here was to repair the world. And it was a theory that you live on a third of your salary, you save a third, and you give away a third. Now, he was lucky because he made a lot of money. And it was actually interesting about Sears, because it was Amazon before it was Amazon. They would have this catalog, and people could order in and look at it. And actually, if Sears had kept that principle, it might not be doing so financially bad today. But it was really a feeling that just because he was doing so well, he should share the wealth. And again, you had mentioned that in the introduction. Here was a man at 16. That's sort of the irony. At 16, he had left formal school to go to New York to apprentice with his family. And I think part of him always felt bad that he had never finished his education and was so good about helping others. And you have people like Ralph Bunch getting it. John Hope Franklin got a Rosenwald, who had an insidious story about when he first was trying to do research in the South. So it's a matter of realizing maybe in your own life what you hadn't achieved to try to give others at least the opportunity to do it, which I think a lot of what the McCarthy Foundation is today. And others.
Some of the names you mentioned ring a bell. We at the University of the District of Columbia gave Dr. John Hope Franklin an honorary degree. I think that was the first year I came, and I got to meet him, which was a great pleasure. Mm-hmm. Julian Bond was our college commencement speaker at Howard University. And the individuals that were recipients of these grants created art for everyone. So it wasn't as if they did it in a vacuum where they did it just for an African-American population. These were artists who were just artists, and everyone appreciates and has benefited from their art, from their music, from their scholarship. So Rosenwald really laid the foundation for producing a generation and generations of individuals who were giving to an entire nation. And internationally as well.
Well, you know, Julian says it in the film. By the way, his father got a Rosenwald grant and then became the head, was a great educator, including being the head of Lincoln. His uncle had gotten a Rosenwald. But he says that, you know, those who got Rosenwald grants produced us who were in the civil rights movement. Mm. And then he ends, one of his lines is, and that was one reason, you know, Obama came out of that. And actually, Obama's domestic advisor, Valerie Jarrett, her mother was a great educator. Barbara Bowman's in the film talking about growing up in the Michigan Garden Apartments. And Valerie Jarrett's great-great-grandfather, Robert Taylor, where there's a stamp of him now, was the architect who designed the schools, which very much on green architecture. On the bonus features, we have a whole section on black architects. So there's like a whole legacy. You can see who got Rosenwald grants on who were involved in service to our country.
Was there any pushback from family members or from others who thought that perhaps this wasn't what he should be doing?
Well, actually, the film concentrates on his giving, especially with African American communities. and in education and the arts. But I have a section in the bonus feature where it talks about his Jewish giving. He was very involved in that. No, not only wasn't there pushback, but the next generation, his daughter in New Orleans was very much involved in the civil rights movement, Edith Stern. She actually welcomed Marian Anderson when others wouldn't. She got involved in voting rights with Cokie Roberts' family. Mm-hmm. Another daughter bought, when MoMA wanted to purchase the Jacob Lawrence series and they split it, it's his daughter that bought it for Museum of Modern Art. Bill Rosenwald, another one of his sons, got very involved in with others in the family of rescuing 300 members of their family out of Nazi Germany. Mm-hmm. So the legacy continued, and the family is very supportive. It was their members that were so supportive of me in making the film. And then foundations today, they do some of the same work, like Ford and Hewlett Packard are supporting the making of the DVD. So it's been really great in terms of realizing that through education, we can spark, I hope, more philanthropy.
Some of the schools, when they were built in some of the southern states, were destroyed, and they were rebuilt. He provided that funding for them to be rebuilt.
Right, and now in today's world, what's even, as I said before, is there, you go all over the South and there's this whole movement, mostly about alumni who feel so strongly. You know, in the bonus feature, we have a whole section on George Wolfe, who's a Tony Award-winning director, and he talks about what it went to go to the Rosenwald School. And I think in the same way a lot of people feel about maybe going to university at Howard, is that, you know, you're with your own, and there was such a support about being educated without being pushed down. Yes. And I think that's really important. You know, that was a very important element in terms of what he was able to do.
What do you hope for the Rosenwald documentary?
I think three things. One is to inspire philanthropy. Because, you know, I keep on thinking when we, you know, I grew up in Detroit, mm-hmm. you know, and they talk about the first dead city, it's coming back. I went to an all-city school, the one that Lily Tomlin and Diana Ross went to.
Oh, okay.
So, and actually it's great because the school, physical school itself has been rebuilt, and the attendance record going to colleges in the 90s. But we know a lot of the elementary schools, there's so many problems, that I was hoping that this Rosenwald model of the community, the city, and philanthropy could join together and make a difference with schools. So I'm hoping just out of philanthropy, and of course giving to artisans. I mean, it took, you know, two of my four films took over 13 years to make. So there's always a problem with resources for artists. Second of all, I just think it's all our joint history that I want people to know about all these thinkers and artists, and also that when there's issues, I mean, he would drive to work, Rosenwald, and realize that with the Great Migration, and so much of the story is the Great Migration, because they were coming north to Chicago, right. And he realized there's not any good housing. Well, let's try to figure out a building, this Michigan Garden Apartments, which has just been restored in multiple housing for both poor people and middle class, that, you know, people look around our communities and say, hey, let's do some kind of community effort. And I think also that we need to be teaching everyone's history in this country. Mm. So, you know, what's interesting about Rosenwald is he both supported Booker T. Washington's philosophy of education, but also Du Bois got two Rosenwalds and agreed also with the talented 10th. And I think that's what we should be doing everywhere in this country.
It is important to, because when you support W.E.B. Du Bois and then you support Booker T. Washington, there's that people sometimes see them as extremes, but actually
They were both right.
And so Rosenwald was supporting both of those efforts. If you had to compare him to a philanthropist today, Bill Gates, Buffett.
Oh, that's interesting. Well, Gates seems to be more involved in health, which is fine. But I think they all, and Soros now, I think they also have this inspiration to make a difference. And I think, you know, that government can't do everything, although it should be doing more. Mm-hmm. And, you know, right now, Darren Walker, what the Ford Foundation is doing, he has, and they've been very generous in supporting the DVD, has talked about Rosenwald being a more social activist philanthropist. Mm. So I'd like to see if there could be a little bit more of that. And I'll, when the DVD comes out next week, I have a whole list of philanthropists I want to personally send this to, the DVD to, and say, watch it all, you know, bonus features and the film, and see if that, you know, doesn't positively influence you on, you know, what differences you can make in society.
I think that's going to be really important, and the DVD is going to enable a lot of elementary, high school, middle school students to be exposed to him and to the history and to those individuals that received the Rosenwald grants.
You know, for instance, in Puerto Rico, we had a real problem with the people really not even being able to eat. You have someone like Jose Andreas, you know, someone who has wonderful restaurants in our community. He just went down and he fed 2 million people.
And those are the kind of activists that we're going to need. And I just want to thank you for bringing Julius Rosenwald to the larger public and exposing him. Thank you so much. And thank you for being here today.
My pleasure.
If you would like to learn more about Aviva Kempner and the Rosenwald film, visit the website, rosenwaldfilm.org. If you are interested in learning more about the academic programs and events offered by the University of the District of Columbia, visit the university's website at www.udc.edu. And to learn more about the many degree, certificate, and training programs offered by the University of the District of Columbia Community College, visit the website at www.cc.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber.
Julius Rosenwald created black schools throughout the South. Without that initiative, we would have had a different America.
It was a little school, a short distance from my home, walking distance. Beautiful little building. It was a Rosenwald school. It was the only school we had.
I thought my school was grand. It was the Lafayette County Training School, so there.
The Rosenwald Fund was the single most important funding agency for African-American culture in the 20th century.
If you look at the list of people who receive money from the Rosenwald Fund, it's literally a who's who of black America.
In the Jewish tradition, we talk about righteous action, this notion of tikkun olam. You do work on repairing the world.